A bit about myself. Used to be myself an entrepreneur, so I've been there. I've been in your shoes, but many, many years ago. I built three companies. One was okay. I managed to sell it at a break-even point, let me put it that way. One was excellent. I made an exit. I didn't have to work for 20 years. And one went bankrupt. So I saw like the three options, right? I mean, success, failure, and something in between in there. Since 2013, I decided to support the community in Belgium, the ecosystem, especially technology startups. I know not everybody views technology startups in terms of digital, yet I think you all of you are innovative. Innovation is very, very hard. Not just in making the product, it's also hard because you have to create a market for it, right? Often, a big part is to go and tell the world that you exist and you have something doing much better. That's not easy. And let me give you an example. Assume I want to open a bakery here in Belgium. What I would do is I look on the map where people are living, population density, right? Against competition, other bakeries, supermarkets, whatever, selling bread. Now take the optimal point, i.e. the highest population, lowest competition. If I open a bakery over there, chances are it's going to be successful, right? If my bread is a bit okay, and you know. Why? Because we're going to put an existing product for an existing market. You can plan it, you can make calculations, you can go to the bank, ask for money, and then how much you want to invest. That's straightforward. Now let's change one parameter. Existing product, new market. I'm going to open, for instance, a bakery, let's say, in China. Will it work? What do you think?
Probably not.
Probably not, okay. Somebody who is a believer? We have a believer in there, two believers even in there. The truth is, we don't know. It's an assumption. It's also an assumption from your side. You might be right, it's going to be a disaster because they have like a rice culture, not a bread culture. It might be the next big thing in China, right? I mean, possibly we have pain quotidien, dialects brood, which managed to go also global with bread. But we don't know. So we changed one parameter, and we actually don't know if it will work or not. Imagine now your situation. You have a new product for a new market. Often that's the case for all of you in there. Actually, you have no clue what you're doing. You don't know. I mean, you're trying things out. Might be a really great product, a great service, but the question is, will the market accept it? Okay? And why is it so hard? Because at the end of the day, let's assume that all of you believe there's a certain market for your product. Well, that's the case, otherwise you're not going to be here, right? That's a very nice bell curve. That's your market. The problem is, all of you, as an individual, you're here, you're an outlier. Actually, you should be somewhere over there, right? But anyway, you're at the end, you're an outlier. There is no way you can make any statement about this market. You try things out, you do experiments, and you see if they work. And sometimes they will not work. I would say often they will not work, but if you're lucky, something will work out. In other words, the art is, next to building a great product, also to get to your market, right? Success will be by how do you manage to get your product, your service, your vision even to the market. And because of that, you need to think about go-to-market. And one way to do that is growth hacking. Does it make sense what I'm saying? Yeah? Okay. I didn't lose you yet? You're still in the right workshop? All right. Now, one of the challenges being a startup is often you don't have a big budget. A go-to-market can be very expensive. You can say, okay, let's open a test bakery in China. It's going to cost €1 million. That's a lot of money for you. That's maybe nothing for a big company. That's a huge way to test it in there. There are different ways you can test it. So the real insight here is, how do I try to bring my product to the market? It doesn't mean it will work, doesn't mean that you will have success, but at least we can try to reach in a very effective way a certain market. So this is the background of growth hacking, or the reason why growth hacking is very important. A business is two things. It's, well, actually it's three things, but anyway. It's you're building a product, you have to bring it to the market. And you need both to be successful. Very often I see really, really amazing stuff built by very smart people, but they are very poor bringing it to the market. And somebody else who doesn't have the best product, but is better in sales and marketing basically, right, is taking the market with an inferior product compared to the superior thing that we're doing in our site. Yeah. And the second thing is, and that's also because of this reason, is often I see a product and I say, wow, it looks really great. I mean, listen to you and listen to what you're saying. It makes sense. I like it. I mean, okay, kind of a drink, recycling, for instance. I mean, music festivals in Belgium. I can see value in all of you in there. And I can like some ideas and I can like what you're doing. But at the end of the day, I am still an outlier. I'll give you an example. 3 years ago, I was at the jury of some program, and there was a company pitching me with a business-to-business analytics product. It was really great, smart people. I liked the product a lot. So, hey, that has potential. The next one pitching, they made an app that can read the thoughts of cats. That's all right. An app that can read. I mean, who in the hell, even the world will be, I mean, even download this kind of apps, and I mean, it's just like a gimmick, right? I mean, point it to your cat and it says, oh, I'm hungry and I don't feel good in there. And I was like, this is going to be a joke, right? 1 year later, we met again the same companies. Guess what? The first one didn't give up, but it was a bit okay. The guys for the app for the cats been to New York for cat conference. There's a lot of people apparently liking there. They have like 1 million downloads. It's a lot of downloads for an app. And the next thing they're going to do is going to Japan because cats are a big thing in Japan. Like, wow, you know, I am not the market. I don't know anything about cats. I mean, how do I know that this has success in there? But at least the guys did very good in terms of growth hacking. Now, let's dive into the subject, unless you have some questions of growth hacking. Yeah? All right, cool. Now, let's give you first a definition of growth hacking. Growth hacking basically is a way to acquire users or customers, to keep them on board, retention in there, using levers. This is normal for any business. Everybody has to acquire customers and retain them, except the government, because it's a monopoly. But everybody else has to do these two things. Yeah? Acquiring, in between you can say serving, and then retention. That's the core of every business. The new thing, what I want to teach you today, is levers. It's going to be the key of the presentation today, is how are you going to use levers? Levers can make you very strong, as you know. If you're superpower. Doing that by creating repeatable and scalable. If you cannot repeat the process, it's like one of it works, next time it doesn't work, you have an issue. You didn't find anything that you can make a process. A second, if you cannot scale it, it only works very locally, you also have an issue if your market has to be quite big. The objective is growth. Growth is the most beautiful thing I see in everything, whether it's children or nature or companies. Growth is your objective. All of you have to grow. Why is that? Why do you need to grow? It's your objective, I guess. And I think it's a good objective, but why do you need to grow? I know it's early in the day, but try to think. Why is growth so important? For you, for your company. The nature. I love this question. That's a very good answer. Perhaps you're right. I think there's also in the nature of humans. You're absolutely right. There's something in there. But then you can argue, I mean, from a company point of view, it's, I mean, artificial as an objective. For yourself, I understand as a person, right? It's the nature. I mean, we are curious and we're learning. That's why you're here today. But from a company point of view, I think it's more, it's an objective in itself more than the nature, I think.
To achieve the point where you, where the fixed costs are being distributed by enough customers.
Okay, it's a very financial approach, but I think it's very good to think in that terms as well. Come back on that. One more answer.
Basically, to be able to compete with your competitors, if you don't grow and if you don't put yourself out there, you're forever going to be losing customers and not regaining them to stay in the market.
Yeah, I like that. I mean, by the way, everybody's right. It's not like a single right answer. There is on yourself financially, right, to get a break-even point, as you call it. Is also, in a big context, the market, where you have to stand up against everybody else. to put it different, putting all the elements together, including your answer, is basically your objective, all of you, is to create something sustainable. Yeah. And to be sustainable means that perhaps you need to be break-even. Very likely you have to be break-even. Perhaps you have to stand up against competition. It's all true. But sustainability is different for all of you. And that's the human nature kind of thing. I would be happy to create something, no, I will not be happy actually, to create something very local. You can make a coffee bar here in Antwerp, and it's going to be a great coffee bar, and it's good enough, right? But not always the case. In some cases, I mean, I look to the group over here, the marketplace people, right, in there. Being very local is not going to be good enough. Being one neighborhood on the platform, one, it's not going to be sustainable, right, in there. Sustainability is very much linked to two things, the human nature, the entrepreneur, you, one side, but also the business you're in. I'll give you an example. For instance, if you are in a winner-takes-all market, and the most famous example you know probably is Uber, you cannot be a local Uber. Somebody tried in Brussels with Jump. Jump was 3 years ago the local Uber. They just replicate the same model from Uber, and now they don't exist because somebody takes the whole market in there. Being Uber, being in the market of Uber, you cannot be that local. You have to be a very global view. Other example, there is a company here in Belgium. In 2010, they had 100 million users. That's a lot of users. Even today, it's a lot, 100 million. But back then, it was like amazing, right? Yet they failed. Who is this company? Netlog. Yes, Netlog. The Facebook of its time. They were the number one website, not only in Belgium, but in 7 European countries. 100 million users all over Europe. Yet they got killed by Facebook. For their business, even 100 million cannot protect them. That's huge, right? In some cases, it might be more smaller. So it depends. Sustainability is a point where the company itself can really generate the value to stay alive. Sometimes it might be that for you, it's going to be good enough as a small company. Some people say, I want to build a business that goes behind me. If I tomorrow stop or something happens to me, business is sustainable. It's something which is very personal. On one side, your answer, but also very business-driven, i.e. your financial-driven or market-driven. That's sustainability. So growth has an objective. It is sustainability. If there is no objective like that, it can be dangerous. It's like cancer, which is uncontrolled growth, right? It can kill, but it has an objective. So you want to grow to get a certain point. And the question you have to ask yourself is, in my business, what's the minimum I need to get to really be sustainable? Does it mean you need to have 10 customers, 1,000, or 1,000,000 customers? I can imagine like a certain few producing products. You cannot make like one single, one single product in your case. It will be very expensive to buy one product, right? Or one bottle with a drink in it. It's going to be very expensive. Maybe you need to make 10,000 products, in your cases, to get there, right? Or user or whatever. So it's good to know that. What do you want to get over the next years? Going to be a business of 100,000. This is the question you have to ask. And starting from there, go back. How to get there? What do I need? Not just in terms of growth hacking and go to market, in terms also financially. How much do you need to get there? What are the milestones? How do you go to the next 10 customers, to 100 customers, to 1,000 customers? And calculate back, right? Basically, what I'm saying is that's how you make your business plan, eh? That you have to present to banks or investors to finance your business. What's the magnitude? It's not going to be exact, but there's a difference between 100 and 1,000. If you say 200, it's still okay. But 100 or 1,000 or 1,000,000 is different business. Okay? Do you have an idea about your own business, how much it's going to be? Do you know it's like a 1,000,000 euro business or 10 million? Do you have any feeling with that? Who thinks he knows or she knows?
I have no this year. In 2018, we need to grow to 70,000 euros, which is not a lot.
But it depends on the business.
It would be a good start for growth.
Okay, so your next milestone is about 100,000 euros.
Yes.
In the next 12 to 16 months. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's a good horizon. All right. Who else?
We have an idea for it, but we focus on big corporates. So small amount of customers, but big ticket sizes of.
Great. And what's the magnitude we're talking about?
It's about 1 million euros for 18 months. So
okay. Only in Europe in 18 months with enterprise customers. We talk about 100 customers? Or
about 5 to 10 customers.
5 to 10 only. Yeah. Super. I would be very impressed if you make that milestone.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong, I'm not questioning what he's doing. I'm just saying that's a big milestone. To get the first €1 million, it's not that simple. Really not. So I would be really impressed. Okay, I'm going to watch you. In a positive way, I mean, that's a good thing. Okay, anyone else who has like the magnitude where he or she needs to be?
We want to turn 500 of our offline customers into online customers. Because we already have a certain database from our current company.
Mm-hmm.
So the first milestone is to turn into the new online way of working.
Okay, 500 customers, excluding providers,
the,
right?
Out of the database.
Okay, so from contacts to contract is about 14,000 to 500.
Yeah.
In the next 4 months, 6 months?
By February.
Okay,
and a small half of a year.
Okay, and how did you get to the database, if I may ask? How did you get to 14,000?
Because we are already in an art business
for decades. So it's a relevant group that you have there. Super, that's the big asset you have. Okay, cool. If you put it in meters.
So I put it in running meters, and that's my...
That's good. That's your KPI, basically. And how long it will take you to get there?
So I give myself now first 1 year to further develop the stuff, and then do testing in the markets.
Yeah.
And then the goal is the year afterwards to go...
Okay. 12 to 24 months, basically. That's your horizon. Okay. To give you a feeling, I don't only not for technology companies, not for everybody here, in there. But that kind of business that you're doing, you will do, the 1 million, it's about 10 companies in Belgium reaching that stage every year. 10 companies. I'm talking about digital business, to be clear. So I don't know for the other products here. But in general, for this type of product, there are only up to 10 companies passing that milestone every year in the whole of Belgium. And these companies can be 5 years, 3 years. I mean, it can be there for a long time as well. Well, not 10 years, but 5, 6 years. So getting this 1 million... it's a huge milestone. Very few companies. I mean, every year, like 300 companies are born, startups, more or less. And only 10 of them passing that stage in there every year. Very, very little, actually. So it will be a big thing to do that, in my opinion. Okay, so growth is the ultimate reason why we want to grow. But behind that is really like making sure we're sustainable. Depends on your kind of business. Interesting thing is that in growth hacking, usually you start from the product. And that's different from the past. In the past, like you create a product and then you put marketing on top of it, right? In here, marketing, especially in the digital environment, has an influence on the product. That's new. I will come back on that, what it really means. And you have also something very interesting. Again, in the online world, you're driven or guided by data. This is also very important. But I think all kinds of your business can collect data as well. The more you have, the more you can make decisions, basically. Now, so let me recap the definition. It's about acquiring and retaining customers, using levers, okay, making them repeatable and scalable. The objective is growth, starting from the product, guided by data. That's more or less the definition that you see over here. By the way, you get the slides, so you don't have to note all these things. You get a copy of the slides. And then something wrong went. There you go. Now, what is a growth hacker? What kind of profile are we talking about? Growth hacking basically is somebody who knows marketing. Really knows marketing, right? I mean, don't get me wrong, it's not easy. That's something easier said than done. But understanding marketing, or at least the basic principles behind it, it's a key thing to do growth hacking. Next to that, it's somebody who knows, especially for digital products, except for the three or four of you, you also need to understand how software works in there. Now, I myself, I am a software engineer, I didn't program for the last 10 years, but still, in there, so I came from that background. And back then, there was a saying among engineers like, marketing, you go to Vlerik or some business schools, and 2 weeks later, you know marketing, right? What's the big thing? Very arrogant, I agree, but that was the thinking. Today, I disagree with that, in the sense like, if you know marketing, it's easier to learn to program than if you know to program and learn marketing. That's an art, very hard to master, but programming becomes very, very easy. Who of you can code? Anyone here? Yeah, two people? Okay. All right. Well, back when I was programming, end of 80s, 90s, it was C++. It's very hard to learn. It's a bit like learning Latin, you know, it's not easy. You have to do everything pretty much yourself manually. Today, programming languages are very, very powerful. I mean, if you are like create a web interface in Ruby on Rails, very quickly you have very nice results. Yeah, if you're much into scripting using Python, you can learn very quickly. Actually, for the ones of you who cannot program, my recommendation is that this weekend, the coming weekend, Saturday morning, start to learn to program. By Sunday, you know how to program. That's amazing, isn't it? And whatever you learn, whether it's Ruby on Rails or something else, not important. Eh? You take some free course, it's even free. By Sunday evening, you know how to program. I'm not claiming that by Monday morning, you're going to be full stack hacker. That's not what I'm claiming. But I can tell you that Monday morning, if you want to create something, let's say Twitter, you can build your own Twitter. So you can really make software. But it's not the objective. Not all of you have to become programmers. But you will do something very interesting. You will understand how it all works. And there is something we'll talk about later, which is APIs, how to integrate your software. And then it's very, very useful. If there's one investment you have to do, irrelevant of your business, for the future, irrelevant of what you're doing today, including the people working for KBC, to be clear, is to learn how to program. It's like mastering a new language in 48 hours. That's a huge thing. Saturday morning, so by Sunday, you're done. Lastly, you have to understand how data works. Today you can capture a lot of data. I will show you some examples, but you can capture, it's huge. And this combination, marketing, part of coding, and data is actually the profile of growth hackers. Any questions? Cool.
Well, should it be one person or can it be a team working together?
Ah, that's a very good question in there. Yeah.
Yes.
Let me put it this way. A team can indeed absorb the different skills necessary, but means you need to have a certain critical size. Often you're a startup, you don't have the means to go and build a team of all different skills in there. So depending on the size of a company, you can also outsource it and there are other options. But basically, in my opinion, all of you here sitting today can have this profile. You can. I mean, today it's not that difficult. Is it going to be the best growth hacker? No. But you have a business to run. It's like one of the things you're doing to get somewhere. Over time, you will grow and you will build a team around that. But to build a team is you have to master it yourself. I mean, it's like sales. A lot of times, the entrepreneurs like you say, well, I'm going to build a product and I'm going to hire a sales guy who will do the sales job for me, right? Especially in B2B. It's not going to work. You first have to do sales yourself. When you master it, you understand it works. Get somebody on board, teach them how to do that. But to think like a sales guy or saleswoman coming on board solving your problem, it's not going to happen. The same thing you have over there. That's why in your stage, I would say master some elements of that. Not everything. I mean, you may be better in this than in that, or it doesn't matter. At least be aware of the dimensions. You grow, it can be a team. There's another question somewhere? Yeah?
For developers for non-tech companies, does that correlate to product designer?
Yeah, that's a good question. For the non-digital companies over here, in there, if you can reach your customers in a digital way, it's worth to do that. It's not about the product side in there. Three of you at least are non-digital in a product side in there. But let's take your example in there. It's a physical product for festivals, we agree. So that's all physical. But I would assume that the way to reach his customers, be aware and he can buy that and purchase it, is for a big part also digital, right? In there.
Yes.
Whether it's 20 or 50, I don't know. So to reach that part in digital way, reaching customers in a new way in there, then I would say it's very important from business go-to-market point of view. Today, every business is digital from that point of view because you can reach people, social media, content marketing, and you name it, in a digital way. That's why it's important. If you have your product also digital, it's a different ballgame because then this becomes part of your product itself. In there. Then you can build actually this also in your product very often. But I believe all of you, if you want to reach a certain segment of the market, you need to master some of these things. Any other questions? Cool. Now, going back to time, this is Google Trends. You can see that it started somewhere in 2013, summer 2013. That's when I discovered growth hacking. I don't know how I stumbled into it, but it was a hot theme in Silicon Valley, where it was all about growth. I didn't know what it was. Honestly, I didn't know what it was. So I was looking, there was nothing existing, no books, nothing. And I started to learn about it because I got triggered, like I think somebody said, I'm here because of the zero budget. I said, wow, I mean, to solve that problem with zero budget, that's a huge thing to solve. So that's when I started to look into the subject. Today, it went even higher. It became quite a big trend. 2013, it was new. Today, I see the emergence in the last 12 months of growth hacking agencies, also here in Belgium, offering these services. But back then, there was nothing there. So started the first community around growth hacking. The first one in Belgium, and it became the number 3 in the world. So you had San Francisco was the number 1 in number of members, then Paris was number 2, and number 3 was Belgium, which is nice, a small country to be in there. So people ask me, so how do you manage to get so many people, right? And I say, well, it's growth hacking. If I cannot deliver that, then it's a bit like ironic, right? You do growth hacking meetup and you cannot even get people to it. I would be wondering about your skills of growth hacking. You can also see that in terms of growth hacking events and meetups, they are pretty much all over the place where you see technology startups, right? I mean, East and West in the US, certain countries in Latin America, all over Europe, really all over Europe in there. This is Israel and South Africa. India has quite a lot, and then certain elements in Southeast Asia and Australia. So wherever you see communities of startups, you always see growth hacking. No surprise, because it's often digital, and second, they all need money, you know, or try to grow with as least as possible amount of money. One of the comments I'm getting very often is, okay, it sounds all great, but are you not just saying the same thing, that growth hacking is marketing? I mean, why would you make a difference between what you... And often, people use different words. They're saying lean marketing, or saying full-stack marketing, or growth marketing. Basically, it's all the same. And I think it's a fair point, except there is one major difference, in my opinion. Difference is simple. If you look into that, and you see somebody who's working in marketing, their objective is to reach a certain number of leads, or reach or customers, using a certain budget. That's not easy. You get a certain budget, and you need to spend it in a way to bring in customers. That's what marketing is about. If you're in marketing, that's what you're doing, more or less. Basically, you're buying customers, right? But if you're in growth hacking, the issue you have is you don't have a budget, right? You have some skills, you have your time maybe, but you don't have a budget. I mean, look at the poor person, he has no clothes almost, like naked, and yet you need to find customers in there. So yes, this is not easy. I would argue this is very, very hard to do, right? Much harder than being in that situation. But sometimes it's good. Having no budget makes you very creative and think different and try different things. Experimenting, well, here you don't have that, I won't say luxury, you don't have that constraint. And creativity, in my opinion, needs constraints. No budget is a great constraint to have, right? To make things different. Often your competition is not another startup, because they might be in other countries. It's often bigger parties, bigger players, right? Which are on this side. And nothing is more satisfying than finding a way to do something better with less budget. I think that's really like nice to do in a marketplace. Now, let's get started with the principles. There are 3 major ones. Basically, if you look to what we're doing is, we always start from your product. This is the core element that you want to get a certain market. And one way to understand marketing is to argue that, you know what, you have a certain market and you have a certain marketing effort you want to do. So on one side of the lever, this is your market, and you have marketing to move that market. In other words, if you put big enough pressure on one side, i.e. marketing, over there, what happens is you're going to move the market. Obviously, there's a correlation between how much effort, read budget, that you have, the more of a market you can reach. which makes sense. If you have more budget, you can reach more people, maybe even convert more people. So there's somehow correlation, right, between these two. Does it make sense, what I'm saying here? Okay. Now, if you go back to our premise, and all of you probably, is in your case, you don't have the benefit of a lot of marketing money or a lot of marketing budget. If you don't have that, what are the alternatives? That's the question you have. That's why I want to use this picture to understand the possibilities you can do. And there are three major ones. The first one is you extend one side of the lever. There's a saying from, I believe, Archimedes, that if you make lever long enough, you can move the earth with one fingertip. I agree it's going to be a very long lever, but still, right? It's about the principle. If you make it longer, it means the effort you need to move the market will be much, much smaller. There's an effort still, but smaller, to move a certain market. So one thing you can do is create a longer lever. But that's very abstract. What does it mean in reality? Reality, this is typically for digital products. If you look to this company here, Spotify, I guess you all know them, right? How come that you know Spotify? Because back then, Spotify had like hundreds of competitors all doing streaming music. It was like the next big thing. But yet, Spotify came on top of it. Why? What happened? Sorry?
The freemium model?
It's an excellent answer, although I would argue that the majority of others did the same thing. It's true what you're saying.
I don't know the other, but
they all died, you don't know them. This is the whole point in there. But the model of freemium was replicated by the majority of them because they knew that from the beginning who would pay for it, right? I mean, in there. Basically, what they did is something very important. They did integration with another product you know very well. It's called Facebook. Because of this integration, if you listen to Spotify, everybody you know on Facebook, your friends, will know what you listen to, and they might want to share the music. I mean, nothing is better to be in the same mood and listen to the same music. By listening to your music, it means you become a Spotify user. So the growth of Facebook enabled the growth of Spotify. Okay? Let me remind you, Facebook was much smaller back then. Okay? Today, it will be harder to repeat the same trick. But back then, this is what happened. Lucky for them is not only they survived that, they also became big themselves. Not everybody managed to do that. One example of a company that failed to do that or grow very fast but was not sustainable is it's a gaming company. One of the games they had on Facebook was Farmville. It was like a game, I don't know if you remember that in there. Well, it was quite popular, but became so spammy and so aggressive in promoting the product that Facebook killed them, basically. Companies still exist, the mother company still exists. The growth was Facebook, but the end was also Facebook. They still survived, just to be clear, but the good old days are over. It was something with a Z, I forgot the name. Z something. And sorry?
Zynga.
Yes, Zynga. Z-Y-N-G-A. Yeah, Zynga. Zynga is a company. They're still existing. They became really big for the same kind of trick, but they really overused it that Facebook also killed them to a certain extent. The other company here is this small little app, right? In there. Who's using Instagram? Okay, half your hipsters, that's good. Instagram was like a small app from New York that nobody heard about. Until they did some integration with two platforms. One of them you know, it's Facebook. The other one is Twitter. They became big, really big, because of integration with these two. The growth of Facebook and Twitter, remember, back then they were smaller, became the growth of Instagram. It's been sold to Facebook. You know how much they paid for? Like $1 billion? $1.1 billion, I think, even. A lot of money. You know how big the team was when they sold it? 13 people, 1-3. 8 software engineers, some marketing, and I think some overhead manager or something, I don't know, CEO, whatever. You can divide 1.1 billion by 13 people. One of them was a Belgian person, by the way. So you can imagine how much money they made. One of the engineers was a Belgian in there. So they became really big. Actually, after Facebook took over Instagram, they tried to block the integration with Twitter as much as possible because they didn't want Twitter to grow more. That was basically the whole plan. What happens here, and this is the key message, is you grow because you use somebody else as a platform to grow. Okay? So the lever is find a place that's growing very fast. In this case, it was Facebook and Twitter. Don't take it today. It's too late. You know, not too late. It's not going to be the same impact you will have. Find a platform where you can grow as well. Give you an example of that. Example from today. One of the great companies I discovered last year, based in London, but I like what they're doing a lot. Let's see how far they get with it. Is they're using the growth of Airbnb to offer a new service. Airbnb is also a platform, right? Growing very fast, right? They're all over the place. They are so big by now. Let me put different. So Airbnb is the number one in the market. Who's number two in the market after Airbnb? Sorry?
Not Booking. It's a different
story. No, Booking is a different model. I would say Booking is even more dangerous for hotels than Airbnb. It's really even more impact to hotels. Airbnb made a new segment in there. But you don't know what the number two is. That says a lot about the power of the platform. So it means they're really big. They became really big, right? And still growing. What this company did in the UK, I think it's a genius thing, is the following. So if your product fails, maybe you can do this kind of thing. I haven't seen it yet in the rest of Europe. So be quick. So you're calling, if you're owning an apartment or a holiday home or something, and you're going to rent it out on Airbnb, right? They're going to contact you and make you an offer you can't refuse, which is, we will help you to generate up to 15% or 20% more revenue without any additional effort from your room or your apartment or your holiday home. Well, sounds like great to me. Like I can get 20%, up to 20%, 15 to 20% more revenue on top of without doing anything. How? We'll come to your place or your place you're renting out. You're going to put there not an iPad, but something similar, a cheaper thing, right? I mean, their own Chinese whatever brand, costs like $100. You're going to put it there. If your guests arrive, they take that tablet and they can order, for instance, food, right? You arrive somewhere. I was in Copenhagen with Airbnb about a month ago. There was not like, yeah, it's like concierge room service, but it's like digital. And you order like, it was not there, but I wish it was there. And it tells you all the food you can order around you. It gives you the tickets if you want tickets to see an attraction or you want to go to the cinema. Everything is there. Normally in a hotel, you go down, you ask all this kind of information. It's there digitally. And you as owner get 15 to 20% of the revenue generated by that. So two things happen. You have a better experience because you get concierge service digitally. And second, I make more money, right? Don't you think it's a great thing to do? The best part is it's easy to find your customers. You just go to Airbnb, you select them, and you contact them, right? How hard can it be there? They're based in London, and I was thinking last year, like, the biggest city in the world for Airbnb is which city? Do you know that? It's Paris. Sorry? Which one did you say?
I was going to say London.
No, it's Paris. Paris is the number one city in number of Airbnb homes. Maybe London is number two, I don't know that. But I know that Paris is number one, somehow I remember it. So it's like, I should replicate it to Paris and just take Paris. It's like big enough to be sustainable, remember? It's a great idea. And once you put your tablet there, right? I mean, okay, you need to give power and internet connection, I agree there. Once it's there, basically, nobody else can enter because once I say, fine, you can install it, somebody calls me and say, you get 22% or something. Why would I switch? I'm happy with the service and it's good enough. It's going to be very hard to beat me. It's like a lock-in situation. So I was like, wow, if I take Paris, check, you know? I mean, it's going to be the biggest city. I really liked the model. Actually, I checked them out maybe like 4 months ago to see how they're doing. The same way we follow your company in the future. I saw now that they're asking even the money back for the tablet, the $100. You as an owner have to pay that, which means they have so much success that they say, you know what, we can even ask money for it, which is good because the investment went down. Yeah. But in the beginning, it was not the case. They were just like growing and then say, well, $100, it's still a very good deal. And for them, it's like a zero operation. They don't even have to invest in hardware. I think it's very, very smart. So that's an example of a startup with a new kind of idea. Using a new platform, not these guys, Airbnb grows. So whenever you see something growing, whatever it is, don't only think Snapchat kind of things, but look further than that, Pinterest or Airbnb or even Uber or whatever you feel something is growing, you might take an opportunity to add you to that, okay? As a way to reach customers. I'm not saying use Airbnb and make a service for Airbnb. I'm just saying, like, try to figure out how to do that in there. Because if they grow and you're early with them, before the rules are all settled and they are like more restricted, you can grow with them. How does it work? It's what we call API integration. API means application program interface. It's the way that software communicates with each other. It's the way that you can access Twitter using the back door, not the user interface, or Facebook or Airbnb or whatever, right? All these things can be accessed using API. It's usually maybe like five rules of code. It's very simple, but you have to understand them. That's why I'm saying by Monday you should know how it works, and you can really do API integration with any platform you like. And for a lot of you, this will be very, very important to do that. Just to be clear, this is not illegal what I'm saying. This is not like hacking. It's like integration. It's not like some kind of shady kind of approach to do that. Questions about level number one, integration with a third-party growing platform. Basically, if you don't have that market impact, use another platform to use that to reach a certain market segment. No questions? How do you grow in there? It's a very good question. For instance, one thing you can do is...
Attentie, attentie. Dit is de maandelijkse test van de omroepinstallatie en sirenes. Bij slechte hoorbaarheid gelieve ster 123 te informeren.
Attention, attention. Nous procédons au test mensuel de l'installation d'appel d'urgence et des sirènes. En cas de mauvaise audibilité...
Attention, attention. This is the monthly test of the public address and alarm systems. To report poor audibility, please dial **123.
Cool. Welcome in the corporate world.
Nice soundtrack on
the... Yeah, it's great for the recording. Yeah. People enjoy it.
I'm sure you can filter it out with software. The question was, a very good question is, how do you know what's the next big thing, right? By the time you hear about it in the mainstream news, I think it's too late. Let me put it that way, right? One thing you can do, what I read every day, for instance, not all the details, is TechCrunch. You know, I read a number of things every day, but TechCrunch gives you like, don't get me wrong, often it's wrong. It's like the next big thing and they're totally wrong. But sometimes you find something which has value in there. So by keeping touch of that, and because experimentation is very cheap, you can quickly find out if things are growing or not in there. But you're right, often it's trial and error. If I could predict the next big thing, I would be a rich man. Mm-hmm. It's as simple as that. Having said that, doesn't mean you should ignore the existing platforms. They're still interesting, but they have less possibilities. Because the more they grow and become powerful, the less rules, the more restrictive in what you can do in there. I mean, 5 years ago, you can do pretty much everything you like on Facebook. Today, it's not that simple. There's a lot of things which are restricted, which can be received as spammy. They can ban you and things like that. There was another question, I think. No? Okay. So that's... Number one, integration with a third party who is bigger than you or is growing faster than you, and get their users as your target market using very little effort. An example of a company that gets banned, maybe it's also good to know, is it was a Belgian company. They had a kind of Instagram variation where you can take pictures of yourself or friends and you can tag clothes, basically. Looks very beautiful. Back 4 years ago, try to think about the name. And what he did, the founder hired someone in India to go and post that link to their website, to download the app, on all Facebook groups. So somebody in India made a list of all Facebook groups and start went in there with his Facebook account or his Arab Facebook account and start putting there, hey, if you want to know about new fashion, go to this website. For 10,000 groups, a lot in there. What happened is that Facebook figured out that somebody was spamming groups. This is like 2014. Yeah, so about 3 months later, they figured out what happens. They banned the whole domain. That was painful because the domain, if you cannot use it in anything, not just on Facebook, it was a big pain point for them because Facebook is a place to share things. So they had to have another domain just to make sure that they were on Facebook. So it can be painful. That was also a growth hack, but not a very good one, looking back. And the company went bankrupt, not because of that, maybe also other things. But it was one of the things he tried. I think it was very smart, but too aggressive, and he got banned for it. That is the first way. The second way is, if you go back to the original picture, like you have the market one side, and you will try to push the other side, and you don't have enough market budget, is you can play with the product. I.e., if you shift product to the left, in this case, here, you will need less effort to move that market. Okay? How does it work? Is virality is built in your product. Examples of that, two ones you surely know, is Dropbox and Skype. Start with Dropbox. Dropbox was very simple. Back in 2004, I moved to Dubai. So I had a need to back up my files. I want to do it in the cloud. And Dropbox gives you an offer. If you invite friends, you get free space. I don't know how much it was. Today it looks ridiculous, but back then it was very hard to get space. Eh? Yeah. It was very expensive to get there. It's the only time in my life that I spammed people I call friends, so-called friends, because I really want to have that space in there. So that's one thing they did to grow. Get more people, you get more free space. And because everybody's files was growing, it took more pictures in 2014, music, whatever, Dropbox grow without using any marketing budget. So the way they did it was to give free space, invite people, and get bigger. It was the cheapest way for them to grow. Skype is also linked to Dubai, so I was living in Dubai. And calling from the Emirates to Belgium was expensive, very expensive. So one thing I did, I took the flight from Dubai to Amsterdam and then train to Brussels. I went to my parents. I installed another computer. I bought a laptop or a computer. I installed Skype. I teach them how to use Skype in there. And I flew back to Dubai to have this kind working. So imagine, I went all the way to Brussels. I did installation, the support, the maintenance, whatever, everything, just to promote somebody else's product, i.e. Skype. Yeah. So this is an example what these products are actually growing using built-in virality. Often, but not always, I mean, Dropbox is not that example. It's used in two-sided marketplaces. And a number of you have marketplace models. Why? It's because what we call Metcalfe's law, or in human language, network effect. Do you know what a network effect is? What's a network effect?
Multiplication by because of the nature of your product, because it connects people and put people together, and therefore they will be promoting your own service.
Yeah, it's true.
So you tell it to one tells it to.
There's an advantage in promoting.
Right. Yes, there's an advantage for you to promote that. Yeah, you are, the two of you are right. To put it simple, imagine the first telephone in the world, right? You built the first telephone in the world. Who are you going to call? There's only one telephone. So the value is zero. The moment you're adding more telephones, the more value the network has, right? So getting more connections gets value for everybody else. Yeah, the same with the fax machine, eh? All these kind of things. So that's in a marketplace environment, the same thing. I mean, you're a marketplace often, some of you. If you can have only one side of the market, not enough, you will not be able to create liquidity, i.e. transactions, and therefore you die. So it's very important. By the way, there is only one country left in the world where fax is still very popular. Which country is that? It died everywhere else.
North Korea.
I like that, yeah. That's actually, it's a very good answer, although it's wrong. I like your thinking, at least. No, it's Japan. Japan is still fax-driven. because 50% of families, more than 50%, still have fax machines, private persons. So therefore, you still have, it's hard to kill it then, right? You have so much value in the network. The other countries, don't know North Korea, was used in business to business and it went digital. But because of the penetration with families and companies, which is 100%, it's so deep integrated that it's very hard to kill faxes. So if you ever want to go to Japan, you better buy a fax machine. So that's virality built in your product. It also means you have to think about how you can promote your product. And not only think digital, because obviously there are digital examples in there. The question is, how can you enforce that your customers can go and carry the message forward? Somebody said word of mouth, promoting it in there. If you can find some way that you put in your product an incentive or a behavior change that people are going to promote it, that will be really, really great. Whatever it is, I mean, often you see like invite other people, you get some reductions. Personally, I don't believe in financial incentives. I believe that if you give something which has value both for you and somebody else, that's really great. Give you an example. PayPal. PayPal became big because they give $10 to the person who brings in a new user, get $10 in his account, but also the new person get $10. So both of them get $10. So it's a very expensive strategy because they grow to 100 million users in like a year's time. Multiply by the $10, they almost went bankrupt, and then eBay took them over, and then they cashed out, and the rest is history, because today, you know, the PayPal founders, like Peter Thiel, first invested in Facebook, and the other one you probably know, he made this little car, what's the name again? Tesla, Elon Musk, it came from PayPal. But they were almost bankrupt, and like 3 weeks of cash, it was like over. So that's one thing you have to think about. I know it's not that easy, but if you can manage to find a way to do that, that's really going to boost your growth. Now, let me show you the impact of that kind of exponential growth, because we say it's going to be quickly, but what does it really mean? Imagine the following scenario. You are a business today doing 1,000 euros per month. Let's say 10,000 per year. That's a very small business, but it's a business. And your objective is to grow every week 1%, i.e. Monday morning, you get out of bed and you focus on only one thing that week. By Sunday evening, you grow 1%. Obviously, it's easy the first week, it gets harder the weeks after, right? That's the whole point. The question is, if you do that for 4 years in a row, every week you're growing 1%, starting from 1,000 euros as a base, where do you end up after 4 years? You have revenue of 7,900 euro per month, okay? Not too bad in there, but then again, I will not call it a business. If you're a good consultant, you make a similar amount of money per month anyway in there, right? So that's 1%. So if you want to build a business, very likely a sustainable business for you, this might not be enough, okay? So you have to be more ambitious. Let's go to, for instance, 2%. What happens if you're gonna push for 2% growth every single week, 4 years in a row? Your revenue after 4 years per month will be 61,000 euros. So not too bad, but means it takes about 4 years, a bit longer even, to get to the 1 million euro milestone that some of you want to have, right? In there. Again, good, but that's just the first milestone. So you have to pause that, you have to be more aggressive or ambitious. Let's jump and go now for 5%. How cool is that? So if you go to 5%, and this is the beauty of cumulative growth, after 4 years, that's what you'll get every month, 25 million. You see, the whole point of growth is if you manage to retain your customers, it's also important, and you keep growing, every percentage point you add cumulatively has a big impact, okay? It's one of the wonders of one of the miracles in economy, it has a name, we think. Compound interest is the same kind of working. If you take interest and you do compound interest over interest, it gets the same thing. It's one of the most beautiful things that you can see. It's that kind of growth. So 5% gives you 25 million a month. That means your business 300 million euro. Maybe in Belgium there, in the last 30 years, not more than 20 companies that managed to get to that stage. It took a bit longer than 4 years even, I think. Very few companies went above 300 million in the technology companies, very few. Today, I think a company which is in that kind of range would be Materialize, 3D printing software. It's a public company in the NASDAQ, here from Leuven. The video software, what it's called, EVH, from also a public company. It's like for sports that you can mix in there, EVH, I believe. They had that kind of range. So very few people really, companies get to that level. Eh? It took them longer than 4 years. So it's quite aggressive. But then again, you're here at South KBC. I'm sure you're more ambitious than that, right? You want to see what 7% will be? You want to skip it? Let's go for 7%. That would be good for the community. 7%, ladies and gentlemen, over 4 years, weekly, gives you 1.3 billion every month. I know the last year will be very hard, but still. 1.3 billion, it's like a company doing like 15 billions. I don't know any technology company in Belgium. In Europe, maybe there are a few of them, maybe SAP, that kind of range. That's about it. It's like one European company in that kind of range, 1.3. So you're a unicorn every month. That would be cool. But that's the impact of the cumulative growth. Anyone more ambitious than the 7%? No? Okay. I'm disappointed. Okay, then. Just for fun, let's go one step higher, right? Just for fun. If you go for the 10%, what will happen over 4 years, you get an amazing number of 407 billion per month. To give you a feeling, what's the GDP of Belgium? It's about this, right? It means you can buy every month Belgium. I think, how cool is that? as an ambition, right? 407, I think that's like the market value today of the top five companies, i.e. Apple is around 500 billion market value. Google will be around that, perhaps Microsoft. So it's like the top, it will be, this is per month, just to be clear, right? It's like every month you build like a Facebook, next month you build like a Tesla, next month, I mean, that would be super cool. You're going to be entrepreneur of the day or the month or year or the century even. If you want to really be ambitious, then that's the way to go. 10% every week, starting from now Monday, but first learn the program and then focus on and grow. Now, the third and the last scenario, do you want to have a break? 5 minutes maybe for a coffee before we dive into? Yeah? 5 minutes break?
Okay. All right.
Cool. Is there some water somewhere, Tom, that we can... So, back to our original plan. We still have a lever. You know the picture by now. One side the market, other side marketing. The beauty is that today you can do marketing at 90% discount. How cool is that, right? I mean, a lot of people spend money on marketing, and marketing agencies and activities. But today there's a brand new world that allows you to use marketing or create marketing assets at a price not possible before, all right? Do you want me to demonstrate you how it works? Okay, let me show you. For instance, where to start? Let's take this example here. I created a number of infographics in the last years. I have a lot of data in there. That's one of the infographics here. Basically, I have an Excel sheet with a lot of data, and then I asked somebody to design this infographic based on all the data I sent them. That's how it looks like. You know how much I paid to make this infographic?
5 euros.
5 euros? Okay. Cool. What's the name of your designer?
I would go to Fiverr with this.
I don't think you will find on Fiverr. On Fiverr, I will not do that on Fiverr. That's my opinion.
In there.
But that's a very good advice you're giving, but not for this. What other platform do you know? Fiverr is a good example. What else do you know? Next to Fiverr? Upwork, yeah. This is more like an Upwork job. I fully agree with you. Then it's still cheap, but not five euros. I will show you some things from Upwork. I will show you some things from Fiverr as well in there. Name another platform. What else do you know? 99design. Excellent choice. Well, when would you use 99design?
Not anymore.
No, scenario, not when would you?
For some basic stuff.
We're probably going to use it for to work, consider it for to work out the logo.
Logos as well.
Yes. It's a place to have creativity for logos or for a website design in there. That's why I would go. And so these are indeed three very good examples. 99 Designs, Upwork, Fiverr. It's a very good combination. Let me show you these platforms, how they work. Let's go to 99 Design as an example. So I and why I use it and why I think you should use it. Here's a logo design. I did this logo. I think 4 years ago or something. Here's a logo. Here it is. This is the logo is being created. This costed me $299. It was back then 250 euros. Not $5, but 250 euros, to be clear. But the key thing is it's not the price in itself, although it's very attractive. The key thing is that there were 36 designers working on this logo, okay? 36 designers. And in average, I mean, they did like two or three designs per iteration. Why is it important? Because we talk about creativity here, right? A logo is a creative thing. The 36 designers come from all over the world. Somebody in Thailand is not seeing the same thing as somebody living in Latin America or in Belgium. So you cannot get access to creativity all over the world. This is the key thing. Back then, I asked an offer from a local agency of a small town in Hessen and Berg, of all places. And they offered me, the offer was 1,500 euros. So it's more like what, a bit more expensive than here. That's not the point for me, the 1,500. I had a budget for it. But the point is, they're going to propose to me three logos from the same designer. And I can choose one of the three, and then they're going to improve it the way I want it. Okay? In here, I would argue you have much more choice than having three proposals for one designer. I'm not questioning the one designer. I'm just saying you have access to a number of people globally, which means talented all over the place. And because often at 99 Designs, who has like more than a million designers connected today, it's an Australian company. Doing very well. It's about 100 people, three offices in Germany, in Australia, Silicon Valley, and also in Asia, I understood. The point is that you will get all this kind of talent from different corners of the world. Now, if you look to designs below, they are removed now, it's 4 years later, but you can see some of them. So here, for instance, you can say, well, that's an ugly one, and give it 0 points, right? But everybody can see that. All the other designs see what you don't like or like. Or you can say, I like this one. I like something with these three colors. That's a nice one. And you can say, I like here the font type. It's futuristic, catalyst. And you see the final one comes a bit close. So other designers can see, oh, he likes this kind of stuff. He likes that kind of fonts. They're going to combine it. And this will be dropped off. The things I don't like, they get 0 stars. They get like 4, 3 stars to really get there. And because they can see from each other, they come to designs like a pyramid, coming to design you like to have, right? And the final three, if you like, you can give them all incentive, but here I took only one winner. You can also share the final or the final three to your friends or customers or partners or whatever, and let them vote for the final design as well. So that's, to me, the creativity you can mine with 99. It's quite interesting. So based on that process, you come to a certain selection. And you can do the same thing with a website. If you want to have a design of a website, how it looks like, not the actual design, making it, in there, you can go to 99 Designs, and you pay to get the design in there. I would pay a bit more than the minimum price to get more interest in there. And these people are really good. I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, if you decide to enter in that kind of competition, it means you have 1 out of 36 chance to be selected. So you better are good, right? Don't stay in the game here if you're not good. It's these are really, really like, I mean, and I think now they are really teams. Eh? They have like in Bangladesh or in Pakistan, really like people doing en masse this kind of stuff in there. Also very important as a rule, if you want like a website design, never, ever give an example of what you like. Because if you do that, everybody will copy just the same. So, oh, this is what I like, just going to copy it. Oh, okay. So don't do that. You just want to explore, open-minded, and see what kind of things you like or don't like. So in the beginning, give a briefing. You're a technology company. You have that kind of product. This is your market. And then you can select things like female, male, strong, modern, traditional, blah, 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 whatever. That's not important. But don't give any example. Never give an example of a logo or a website. Yes?
Is it about what you like or what your customers like?
That's a very good question.
Because here you see 100 possible logos, and you decide to give them stars or...
Yeah.
But you should actually connect to 100 potential customers.
Yeah, it's a very good remark. What do you think? I mean, the other people here. Would you saying, it's the logo I want to have for my company, that's why I stand for, or do you believe that you should involve your customers? And today you can, because with this tool you can invite everybody you like to give stars or not. In there, what do you think?
Both.
Sorry?
Both. You have to like your own logo, no?
Some people, I think, disagree. I think you have also a point, but it depends who you are and how you look to life even, right, in there. My view is, if you start from the beginning involving a lot of people, it's going to be chaotic because you get opposite directions in there. I do believe if you have like the final selection of, let's say, three of them, and all three you like, but definitely because you selected them, to make a final decision, you can go and ask an opinion. But from the beginning to involve in the process, I mean, if you're a designer and somebody says, this is great, and somebody, this sucks, what do you need to do, right? Yeah, it's hard. So you need to at least go for the short term. It's a view. I'm not saying you should do that. Make your short list, 3, 5, 10 is maybe 2, but let's say 3 to 5 in there. If you want for the last step, you can involve customers to get voting. You can still ignore it, by the way, but that's dangerous. And you can do that. But from the beginning, it will be very hard to come to a result in there. And sometimes, number of you have a clear vision. Who you are, what you want to reach. You're very clear what you want to have. You have, you know, your DNA. It's my vision and I want this kind of logo. And it's your choice to do that. And there's nothing wrong with that. So it depends who you are. There's not like a right or wrong answer. I just would avoid to involve a lot of people in the early stage of the design in there.
It was an opportunistic question for myself. Should I call these guys and put my API on their website and say, okay, you can ask to my community which of these three is preferred by the community if you pay $5 more? You see what I was thinking?
No. So you call these guys? Who are these guys? The designers?
No, like that you have the option. Okay, you have your final three selection, and then now ask the crowd. Ask opinion.
But you can today, yeah? You can.
You can do it there.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, the platform is allowing you to invite third party.
But you invite.
Yes, it's you. You have to put email addresses, basically. They're not going to provide it to you in there. So what you're saying is the design community will respond.
Yeah.
Okay. But then again, it will be chaotic. Eh? This is very hard to nail down. Eh? I mean, look to these designs. I mean, obviously for me, but I'm talking about myself here, some things, take these six here. Okay, let's do a voting. Who likes this logo? You have to select between these six. Eh? Who likes this logo? Okay, four votes. Okay, cool. What about this? Nobody. Okay, 0 points. This one? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, that's also good. You can also vote more than once, like you do. That's fine. No, that's okay. That's cool. What about this? Nobody? Okay, somebody takes it like, what this kind of ugly thing it is. Yeah. What about this? One person? Fair enough. Okay, it's very brave. Lastly, this one? Also one in there. Okay, so we have a winner, but it was like close. It was the third one here in there. But once again, my own preference being in there would be also like selecting these two here and get a vote for these two. That's what I would do as well in there. Or maybe even combine things and say, I like maybe this bit more and maybe a combination is also possible in there. But hey, I mean, it's like a sample size. It's a certain view. It's very, very hard. I mean, if you have a view like your DNA, your company is exactly this, there is some symbolic behind, I don't know, the moon or something, whatever it is. Or, it's also important, is your market segment is different than who you are yourself. I mean, your customers are different class or different ethnic or different country. This might be the best logo from an impact on the market. This is the whole point. But it's a discussion which is very hard to have. Even among designers, the case is different. Opinions are in there. Some things you can argue, like, yes, but this is easier. I mean, a black background, you know, that's harder to replicate. Fine. But it's very hard to put a rule in there. I would argue, like, select your shortlist and make the vote. In this case, I would go with the vote. I would have the last two selected, and this would be the winner because I had a bit more votes in there. But sometimes you can be very bold and take this and say, this is going to be the next big thing in the world, and you push it. Before we know it, get used to it, right? So why not? Other questions about 99 Designs, how to use it? Yeah. So typically, logo, I think that's a very good one, but a bit more than the minimum price. You get 30, 35 designers, it's enough. Don't go for, if you put 1,000 euros, you will get hundreds of designers. That's crazy because you have to manage that. You have to give feedback, like, not like. And if you like it, say what you like about it. Is it this or something else or whatever it is? So be careful with that to manage it. Too much money is difficult, but the minimum I would go a bit higher than that. 30, 35, it's a very good number. If you go for a website, the same thing. Don't give any examples, like here, in there. Just tell them your business, what you like, or describe your business. See what comes out of it. Let them surprise you. If you don't like anything, it's possible. You don't need to point a winner. You get your money back, and that's also fine. Okay, so that's important to. But if you like something in there, then pay for it. Don't say I'm gonna. It's a growth hack. I'm gonna do this, and I take the best, and I'm not gonna pay for it. There is also a legal background. If you buy it here, you also get the rights transferred from the designer to you. If you don't do that, you might be in a gray area. Forget about the ethical part. Even legally, don't do that. But if you don't like what's there, there's nothing wrong in canceling your competition here. And nobody, there's no winner, and you get your money back from 99 Designs. If you do it 5 times in a row, they might ban you. You get a bad name. So websites or collateral, and you want to go very broad, you pay up to 5 times cheaper than typical in Belgium, 5 times more or less. And you want to go very broad, you want creativity, then collateral, then 99 Designs is the way to go. So that's one thing. What about the other two? The Fiverr and the Upwork. Who's using Upwork here? One? Okay. What do you use it for, may I ask? That's in the typical designer there. So the one I showed you here before, that's typical I would use from Upwork in this case, but and some other examples. While I would use Upwork, and then I will show you some Fiverr examples as well, is I will show Fiverr in a minute, but an example would be a cover. I write 2 books a year, and I need to have a cover design. Same thing if I go to my publisher here in Belgium, they propose to me like 3 covers, what you like, and they can adapt a little bit, and that's it. Here, using Fiverr, I'm getting much more. Here we can see the examples. So that's a cover about about a book about pricing, lean pricing, pricing for startups. It's a very good book. It's even a workshop within South KBC given by Lode and Katrina, I believe. But I made the slides and the content for that. So I was looking for a book cover, right? So the briefing is simple. The subject is lean pricing. The audience is startups in there. Make me a cover, right? And this is what I get in there. But that's only one cover. So if you look here, you see another variation. Somebody was thinking about putting sale there and things like that. And one thing that came up, which I really liked, is a small detail, but it's an important one. Here it says lean and learn. There's an R in between. That's a design element that I really appreciate. It's like playing with it, lean, learn. I think it's a good one. It came from this exercise. So what I like here is very much that. But other than that, well, this is more like, I don't know, like a sale kind of thing, right? I mean, you know, you're here in the mayor in Antwerp. So that's not something I liked. But bottom line, that's one thing I liked a lot there. And then you get variations. So somebody puts books there for whatever reason, but fine. And I already took the it has to be in there. So everybody get the same briefing. So I improved with the iteration. Here, I did it without, again, like, well, because it's not really perfect. Eh? I mean, it's a bit breaking. So again, I looked without it, maybe in there. I start to like this color. I start to have a good feeling about this lean pricing, the red thing I like, start to like. So I already learned color-wise what I like is the red. But I still keep going with this theme. Again, back to the book. The same as the beginning, but it's mirrored on the other side. It's also the mirror of it, so different variations. Here, I liked that kind of design. So it became like this I like. I like playing with the earth, but I don't feel good about it. And I like also the colors. So this is from different designers. Eh? So that's one designer that I liked. This is from somebody else I liked, and I like the color. So I learned from three different sources, three things I want to keep in my final cover. And you see, I still struggle with this R. Eh? Put it there in gray or red, but then you don't have the lean anymore, or take out the full thing. It's a different design, something about he or she made a word cloud with words that could come from the book, about pricing. That was the whole idea. Nice. But in reality, it's not really like successful. Here is again a version with the R, because every time they're putting, I said, okay, can you put R in there or put it out to see the different things? Very annoying for them, I guess. That's totally different. I mean, the first time I said, like, this, in there. But you could argue if you put this in a library, people will see that, right? They might think it's an art book maybe, but it jumps out, right? I mean, although I didn't like it, I thought like maybe it will be something different. But it didn't go in that way. But I like that somebody came up with something totally different. And the variations. And here we're getting, I look to this annoying R. I mean, it jumps up and down, it becomes colors. It's really annoying me. I like it a lot, but I'm not getting there. Until, and you see, then I put it back down. I came to the final result. Can you see the solution? Yeah, you see it? It's the R over the N, yeah? But it took me 50 iterations to get there. Once you see it, you say, okay, this is the solution, okay? So you see here, I solved what I want to have as a picture, if you like, from different sources. I or the designers fixed the final problem or the R and N, which is very important. And it's the elegance, once you see it, of course, but it took a lot of jumping up and down, colors, kill it, no, whatever. And I liked also this the color here that's been used. It's the same color. I liked as well. But I can only do that because I had a lot of people designed for me. Okay, here I went to Fiverr because it cost $5. It's what, like 4 euros, like a Starbucks coffee, right? Which means you can ask 10 people to do that. And you can say, okay, and at least change it, whatever. So you can go very broad once again. But here you have individual control, different than the competition at 99 Design. You can try in parallel number of things, see what happens. So it was a good example. And finally, that's the design we finalized, came out to this, which became the final cover of the book. And it influenced also the book itself. That's typical, broad, Fiverr, number of things for $5, see what happens. And for $5, you get like one full thing. I can say, okay, that's your design. Can you change that, add R, go up, down, whatever. Get like 5 versions. So it's like $1 per cover. Basically, what you saw is like $1. And the whole thing cost me, I don't know, like 30, 40 euros. Yeah. Compare this to the designer from one designer, give me 3 covers, I have to select and give feedback. Would never came to that kind of solutions with the elegant things and all the design elements in there. That's mining creativity globally. I don't know where the winner came from, which country, doesn't really matter. But that's how I came to the cover. Now, to go from here and create the book, that's a different thing. Because if you want to work with different designers on a book, it's going to be very hard. But I knew what I want now, because I really have a template. And I can show you here. Pricing. Yeah. That's the book. Here it is. So voilà, that's how the book looks like. And you can see the same colors coming back. And you still have that same kind of a bit red kind of color coming back inside the book. Every page I spent hours of work to get it right, the font type and whatever. You see the same colors here coming back again. So it's very consistent. The pictures was a long hand selection kind of thing to go to all different propositions. It's like months of work done by people from Upwork. I used two designers to get to this in there. And that's the final book. Taking all the detail, all the design elements in there, again, the same consistent color. It was a lot of work, not really at my side, because I have just to manage that process. But basically, when the book was ready, here, my publisher, they're from Bruges, Die Keuren. They're normally doing two kinds of books, like typical school books and art books, beautiful art books. If you go to Die Keuren in Bruges, you enter that, you see all these art books. One of the books you see there is this book. They liked so much that they put it there as one example of a book. None of it has been designed by them. The whole thing, I give them the InDesign file, Adobe InDesign, hand over, they added to the logo of Die Keuren on the cover, and the ISBN number, which you need to have if you publish a book, and done deal. They put in a printer and it came out. It was like, they never saw something like that. And they didn't understand that the world was changing for them, like, but we are publishers, we are the one doing that. And then out of the blue, I came with the final product, at least, I would say, really like hiding their own norms. I mean, I published like 4 books with them. They did the design and everything. I can tell you this is the most beautiful book out there. Okay. Why? Not because they are not good people at Die Keuren. It's because they have 1 or 2 designers and I can access 1 million people if I like. Take the best I can, came to something, combine it and get there. Of course, it requires also vision. I want to see the book. I know what I want more or less. Like here, it was important for me, a lot of white space. And you can see the design of the book has a lot of white space because you have to think about things. I want you to think about pricing. Yeah? Price is very, very important. So give you, it's a requirement for me in there. One thing that I didn't know is because of the size of the book, I don't have a copy with me, but I'm sure this one at Start KBC, is the book was expensive to send by post because as a special format, you had to pay more. So that was one mistake I made. I'm not a publisher, how do I know? So they complained that it was really expensive to send it to the US and things like that. But other than that, I think it shows that me, I don't know anything about publishing, using, in this case, Fiverr for the cover iteration and Upwork to get 1 or 2 designers, I can create a piece of work at least the same level as a professional in the publishing industry. So that's typical, high quality, 99 designs work. Yeah? Still a fraction of the cost we're paying to local here. This will cost at a local publisher between 5,000 and 10,000 euros to get this done based on one of their templates. It's this will cost between 500 and 1,000 euros. Like I said, it's 90% cheaper, right, compared to normal prices here. Maybe also important here is basically if I take, so I have this book, I'm doing workshops about the subject of pricing in there. So I took somebody, again from 99 Designs, to create for me the slides to do the workshop. Two things actually. First, based on the book I just showed you, I made a summary as promotion material. It looks like a slide doc. Here it is. So the same kind of content, looks a bit different, which summarized this in 30 pages, like a summary of the book. It looks a bit different, basically, I mean, the colors are a bit different. And I upload this on SlideShare because I want this to be a promotion. So you can download this for free. If you want more information, you can go and buy the full book on Amazon or bol.com or whatever. So that's one of the things I use somebody to translate the whole book into kind of summary that I can publish. At some point, I use this promotion material. I sent it to a publisher in the US who's focusing on startups. And he wrote back to me, wow, it looks so beautiful, right? But it's a little bit tiny to be a book. I know, it's just promotion material. I mean, what's the point? I mean, the whole book is 200-something pages. So he thought it was a whole book. It was a bit miscommunication because it looked like really finished. It has chapters and everything. And then, of course, I have I created these slides, which you recognize from here, but it's the same kind of templates. And that's about how you do the pricing. So these kind of things are based on that. That's typical 99 designs. So based on the book, I made a summary, like an ebook, if you like, but also I use it to create slides, which I can use in workshop. Typically 99 designs. That's where you find all these kind of skills. The problem is not to find the problem is to find the right skills, because there's a million people out there. If you go there and you say, listen, I like to have my PowerPoint or my keynote presentation to be pimped up, what do you get? You get 100 people offering their services. How do you get a select from these 100 people, the right people? How do you do that? Here's the way to do that. First of all, and I can show you that even. You upload a couple of slides. So an example would be, no, that's not the right one. I will show you in a second, but it's this thing. So here's a presentation that I made. And as you can see, I just put in some information. And I don't care really about how it looks like. I just copy things from the internet and I put things in there, like this stuff. And I will upload part of these slides, 3 to 4 slides, up to Upwork. And I pay here a premium price, because I want to have the best designers, of $10 per slide, which means for 10 slides, about $100. If you do $100, it means a lot of people want to do that, not only from third world countries, also from Western Europe or the US, because $100, somebody can do a template. And if you upload these 3 slides, I would invite them and say, listen, you have 2 choices. If you want to get this project and earn $100, or you send me, or you take these 3 slides and you're going to apply the study you want to do on 1 or 2 or 3 slides. So this is what you want, what it looks like. It would be easy for me to see the impact. Or you give me an example of a style you want to apply. One example, right? So if you want to put an effort, you can design and improve the slide. If you want to say, well, no, I mean, I'm just going to give you an example of the style I want to apply, it's also fine with me. That's the request, okay? What happens is the 100 people replying will ignore my request. 95% of them will say, dear Mr. or dear Mr. Madam or dear purchaser, right? Very generic. I am the best designer in blah, blah, blah. Look to my 500 links and portfolio, check it all out, and you see I'm the best kind of thing. Eh? Long text, a lot of links and portfolios. By the time I finish 100 people to review that, I'm like 2 months later. It's not going to work, right? So what you do is you delete all these kind of generic answers. It's spam. Delete, delete, delete. And you leave the 5 who at least were reading what you were saying and apply to your style or give you an example. One example. Okay, if it's 2, you can still be tolerant, right? Let's say 2. But ask 1 and accept 2. Not more than 3. So from the 5, you take the 1 you like most. Like we all saw, taste is very personal, the thing that you think is nice. Next time, you need to have again a slide deck to be designed. Do the same process, okay? Invite people again. Do this 5 times. After the 5th times, 1 out of these 5, which you think is the best, you keep for your future designer, okay? You can be lucky the first time. It takes an average 5 times to get to somebody which is he or she has real talent. And if you see a talent, then keep a talent for yourself. Yeah? I was giving 2013-14 workshops, and people came to me after that and said, hey, Omar, great slides. Who was the designer? Which is very insulting to me, as if I cannot make any slides. But it was true. They were really looking like beautiful. And I was working back then by one person from Romania. He was doing all the stuff for me in 2013-14. And then after a while, 3 months later, he became not twice, but 5 times so expensive. 5 times! So I was making them like, how come? I mean, a lot of customers, yeah. a lot from Belgium, he wrote. But that's me, giving him all this in there. So I, as a rule, once you find a great designer, never, ever share that person, okay? It will be too, I mean, it's amazing. They got all the jobs, I think, from, because all those people really liked my slides. I said, oh, this is the guy, and they all went to him. A very talented person, but became really, really expensive. So that's how you select from this very broad coming into you, and step by step, they get better and better. And once you have really talent, you keep them. By now, I use 30 people, 30 people, for a lot of activities. I will show you some other stuff. For instance, video, that's one example. Let me show you a video. Do you like it? It's like very short, 1 minute something in there. Very like, have you seen synchronization between the music and how you did it? It's very well done in there. It costs like $180, 150 euros to make that kind of video. If I show you the briefing, it was just like this. That's the briefing or a sample of the briefing. It's maybe better. But you can see which I was sending to them, and based on this they made actually the video. Now, somebody who knows a bit about video told me like, that's fine, Omar, but that person used a template. It's a template, which is okay, you know. I still like it, whether it's template or custom-made, it doesn't really matter. So it might be a template, but I think for this price, I got a price in Belgium, it was 5,000 euros to make a video of 1 minute, 90 seconds, basically, in there. So for 150 euros, you can have a video. You can also go cheaper, eh? I mean, there's a lot of possibilities. Depends what you like, the level of quality. I personally like to go for quality. I don't want to go for the cheapest, I want to go for a certain quality. And I'm more interested in how much I can explore from a number of talented people, rather than having this. To give an example of talent, which is even hard to find locally, I mean, I wrote some ebooks. One of them is this one. It's called Genesis, it's about the ID stage. What do you do in the ID stage as being a startup? So this is the stuff I'm writing. And as you can see, that's a good slide. I don't care how it looks like. I take something which is really ugly, as long as it's being really clear. Here, I want to convey the ID to somebody who doesn't always speak English very well, like it's a blip in a brain and it gives an ID, right? It's like these ugly brains that I copied from internet and this stuff and this as well, but funny, but everybody would understand, right? In there. This is the whole point. You don't have to look to the aesthetics, just what's the point you want to make. This here, if you go to 99 Designs and you get a review, I mean, getting the whole makeover if you like, you get something like this. Same content. I would argue it looks a bit better now. Mm-hmm. No, we're not talking about designer. It's another designer, but bottom line, if you look to the picture I showed you early on with the brains, here, this is the picture. And you see it's all there, the brains are in here, the bulb is there, and the blip is also the circuit around it. That's the final result from the message. So, okay, fine, you have somebody who can do it for you, that's not an issue. This is like 100 pages, you count about 500 euros to make that. It's about 500 euros to the full ebook. It can go cheaper, but that's to me like the quality I want to have. Now comes something more important. Oh, by the way, I had to give a workshop in Romania about this, and this is in English, so I get somebody to translate it in Romanian, and where is it? Here it is. So the same book, but then in that language. I'm not so sure, except engineer, I could read my name in there. I asked my host to read it before I give it to them, because I don't know the quality of it. I paid about 150 euros to do translation of all these things, but it seems to be really okay to have this full thing, 100 pages being translated in Romanian. And then while after that, I had to go to St. Petersburg in Russia, same workshop, and then I had to, for 150 euros also translation. Now, I cannot even read the characters anymore in there. I was worried about my title. I mean, this is bizarre. Right? Are you sure this is my title? But again, the university told me this is like good quality of translation, and then it was fine. So you can really translate this in a number of languages for a fraction of the cost you used to pay in the past, right? At least acceptable quality. I will not say this literature. I don't know that. At least it's business-wise, it's good enough. Put it that way. But this is easy, straightforward, typical 99 designs kind of profiles. Now, I had to give a workshop, which means I cannot go and present this way. I mean, there's something you have to read, not something I can present, I mean, all the text. So I needed somebody who will read the book, or the original one, the English one, of course, and translate into, I think, a 2 hours workshop, right? So you have to read the book, you have to understand what it all means, you have to put it in a format of a workshop, right, for 2 hours, and you have to design it as well, right? I mean, very hard to find. I mean, that's, to me, talent, very hard to find. That's the results of the exercise. It was a lady from Thailand, and she made this. You can recognize the cover of the book in there, but the rest of the style is a bit, it's a bit different at this stage. First of all, that was quite funny. It was my workshop, because I know the content, I wrote the book. And she was explaining to me on Skype, I have to talk like the first 15 minutes about this subject. And then the next 20 minutes about this. She was briefing me on my own workshop, so she must be exercising in front of a mirror. And it was 2 hours. So I had to put here comments, you can see below, that I know myself, like what kind of structure is in there. So she briefed me we did this on 2 hours on Skype, and it was perfectly timed. She really, it's like a month of work to do this full thing. But it was funny that she was briefing me for my own workshop. So that was quite cool. But on top of it, if you look to the metaphors she was using, the pictures here, she used a picture of somebody designing fashion clothes, which I'm not using in my ebook. This is not coming from me. But she translated into this. So, you know, the opportunity, it's empty. And then you go and design, and you create your product, and then you go to the market, checking the colors. All this stuff is not my, it's her own creativity that she added to it in there. I think it's very crispy, it's well done, not only from design point of view. So this whole thing here is made by somebody who worked a month to create that kind of thing. It cost about $500, 500 euros, I don't remember, something like that, in there. I can tell you to find somebody who's able to read something, to put it in a format of a workshop, to make it, I mean, put on a higher level and visually also very crispy, I don't know many people who can do that, just to be very clear, okay? So that's what I mean. I have a virtual marketing team globally creating pretty much everything I want, I mean, in there. I mean, videos, infographics, that kind of e-books in there. Or let's say I have an infographic like this one. Here, it's a good example, which is way too small to read. I cannot present that here in there, so I have to zoom in a number of things to look to all the details. That can be translated into a Prezi, and it costs you like $50, I think, more or less. So you get something like this. The same infographic, I mean the same structure, it's just like it's a better way of presenting it than just a big thing. Can you do it yourself? Yes, but for the effort you have to do for $50, that's 40 euros, it doesn't make sense. You can see the background moves at different speed, kind of nice things. So that kind of things you can create like on the finger. I mean, it's very, very easy. The other thing I like a lot, if you're using Fiverr, if you want to make a video, let's assume that you have a presentation in PowerPoint or Keynote, you can save that as a video, right? You can just save as a video. 10 slides is about 4 minutes. You can go to Fiverr and you can ask somebody to create for you a transcript, i.e. the text to go with the presentation. It costs you about $10 on Fiverr, okay? And then you ask somebody to do the recording of the voice. It costs you $5 per minute. And the nice thing about it is you have no quality issues because you know beforehand what you will buy. So if we go to Fiverr here, let's say I want to have voiceover. Let's take here, Pro voiceover, he claims. Do you like it? We're clear freestone rivers. Very, and pristine mountain lakes. Not the type. Let's take female Spanish voiceover. Okay, why not? Very important, don't look to the pictures because you get influenced by what you're saying. If you want to have the voice, close your eyes and listen to the voice. Two comments.
My Spanish is clear.
Why would you take English voice with a Spanish accent? It doesn't really make sense. Whether she's doing it in Spanish, which is okay. And the second thing I would say here is she's putting music in the background. I don't like it. I want to hear the voice clear in there. So bottom line, close your eyes every time. You want to have more UK or American, female or male. Depends what you want to have. You can select a lot. You can also go for Dutch, for instance, language. You want to see the accent? Yeah. Let's see Dutch. If you want to go local, let's see this guy. Dutch voice over, powerful. I will be your Dutch voice over. That's good. Okay, close your eyes. Exactly as been predicted, right? I mean, honestly, it's like the cliche almost. But it works in the Netherlands, so why not in there? But here's somebody who says, I have a Flemish or Dutch. That would be impressive. So both. Okay, let's see. Het is Flemish. It's not my type of voice in there, but indeed. I think you can even take accents. And you can say Dutch Flemish, for instance, in there. And you can only have then, I don't know, Dutch. Doesn't really sound Flemish, but okay. I mean, the one before was Flemish accent. That's correct. Or you take French with a Spanish accent or whatever, I mean, or Belgian French. So these things, there's nothing you can do wrong because you can hear before what you like. You pay $5 per minute, so it costs you like $20 to get like the video. Don't deal. You have your video, made in PowerPoint, whatever, saved with your transcript, $10, $20, costs you like $30 without any pimping, just straightforward, €25. So this is quite simple to do in there. If you want to create your videos more advanced, fine, then you have to do some other things. But Fiverr is typical the way to go for that kind of things. Questions about Fiverr or how I'm using it here? No? So this 99 Designs, there is Fiverr, this one, and there is Upwork. These are the three major ones in there. Depending what you're looking for, you can decide which way you want to go. There are other things. Eh? I mean, there was at some point something, it was a horrible name, like Cheap People or something. Cheap People. Yeah, really, something like Cheap People.
And there is also
Ah, so my
price of
fiber? Yeah, 10. Yeah, but a fiber you can also go higher. Eh? So it's five is the minimum. You can see there it's 419, but some are more expensive. My Cheap Jobs. But it was so bad, it changed the name now. If I open My Cheap Jobs, now it's called. It was really horrible. The cheap people, and it doesn't even exist anymore. Ah, Do Jobs Online is a new name. It seems to be very successful in there. I'm sure there's a lot of different platforms, but bottom line, these are the major three ones. 99 Designs, website design logos, going very broad, very, very broad. Fiverr, depending if you want to do like broad iteration, trying things out. Give you an example. I was, there it is, buy here, simple risk free. Yeah, really. I was doing a community in Leuven to help them start a community in Leuven about startups. There, what I did is, because we don't have a budget, and it's like not for profit kind of thing. If you look to that, Leuven's communities, here it is, Leuven Startups. You can see here that this is the logo of Leuven Startups. That's made on Fiverr. Okay, it was only worth my $5, my coffee, as contribution to the community. So I didn't go to the full thing and paid $300, $400. I paid just $5. I picked, I think, three different designers. So it's $15. I took the best and I did a briefing, like, because it was Leuven. This is VOCA, the Chamber of Commerce. This is the city of Leuven. And this is KU Leuven, the colors of the three things. And I told them I need a very futuristic kind of letter type, a font type, and that's it. So you can do that. I did it here for $5 or $15, if you like, for the three versions. But if you really do a logo of your own startup, I would invest a bit more in your visual identity than just $5. But you can. I prove here you can do that. The covers was great because then I had all these different variations and I could get to something I like. And then you can go to 99 Designs to do everything else or to Upwork. It depends. It depends what you want, how much you budget, what impact you want, the quality that you want, or the lack of quality. Sometimes you want something very quick. My bottom line is, that's the message of the last slide here in growth hacking, this one. Here it is. There is, and I would add 99 Designs to it either. Today, creating marketing assets becomes really, really cheap. Okay? So you don't need to have really big budgets. You can do great stuff, videos, infographics, praises, you name it. E-books, slide decks, all this stuff you can do. You can create content. You can have copywriters for you on Fiverr. Even on Fiverr, you can do that. Let's say you have this presentation here. I can go to Fiverr, and I pay $10, like €8, to get somebody to write out the storyline of this, like a 1,000-word article, not much more. Will it be good? No. But I don't mind, because writing things costs time. If I get like a draft version, if it's not that good, I can change it myself and it's final. And the benefit is you do it by a native speaker. I'm not a native speaker in English, right? So I don't know all the expressions and the details. And somebody who's a native speaker will do it for $10. I have like sentences I would never been using. So at least my final result, okay, I have to put 2 hours of work in it. But the final result will be really good. It costs me like 2 hours of work instead of like writing a whole day for putting this in an article, right? If you go to 99 Designs, you pay $100, but then you have a professional copywriter, you don't have to put 2 hours of work in it. Yeah, it depends. I have $100, I have no time, go for Upwork. Copywriter high level. If you don't have a lot of budget, pay $5 to $10, make an article for instance, but finish it yourself in 2 hours. So like get the heavy lifting out of the way and only do the finalization. Depends what you like. You have budget to make a video, go get a video expert on Upwork to do the things for you. Don't have a lot of budget, go and do something yourself in PowerPoint or Keynote, save it, take a voice over, transcript, don't deal, right? I mean, enough to do something there. Yes?
And where would you go for hiring a guy like that over there in Liberia?
Local guy in there. You can find local people in there. There's a number of platforms who are generic. My view is if you want to go in that direction, it's what you want to do is create a community around a specific subject. So I hope that guy over there will be on your platform.
No, that's the right answer.
I know, it was so obvious, but okay, do I look that stupid? No. But you're right, I believe that there is a market for niche, because Upwork is very, very broad, for pretty much everything. But if you want to know the direction, you have to go niche. The same thing what you want to do, you have a local element in there. You have, what is it called in the US, Rabbits, or the platform is generic in all this kind of doing little gigs. TaskRabbits. In there, which is a global task, it's like a global kind. He wants to go for peer-to-peer local approach, which is different. It's niche. I think it's the way to go. Will it have success? I don't know, but that's the way to go there. So I agree with you that there is a niche. There's also a niche for pictures. There is a niche for infographics. There's websites only doing infographics in there. But to me, to go to 15, 20 different websites is complex, because I am not using everyday video. I do it like once or twice a year. So use the generic part. But if you want to go deeper, I would go more niche. You're absolutely right. There's space for that, in my opinion, especially in B2B. Consumers is a bit different thing. Other questions? How to use platforms to create marketing assets? So you have no excuses. I mean, your website will be great, your flyers, your everything can be look really, really great. 2D rendering, you can do this kind of stuff. I mean, if you have product designs, video, how to look before, after, go there, create something stunning, or much cheaper, but still having certain impact. That's to me like a game changer, especially accessing talent. Eh? I saw you, the lady from Thailand, that kind of profile, very hard to find. Irrelevant to where you're looking for, not Europe or in Belgium. Forget the price, it was cheap, but still, finding that kind of profile is very, very hard. And if you found somebody like that, keep it for yourself. Your own virtual team, where you can compete with big corporations. And one benefit you have as a startup is you can do that. I'm sure that KBC will not allow you to do that, right? You have to go to the communication department, get approvals. So it's all there, but you can't use it, right? Which is really challenging. All right, no questions? How to use it, how to do that? Cool. So we saw three different levers. What are these three? The first one was?
Marketing.
Yeah, it's extended. Or use a platform. If you don't have a big market yet, use another market access way, integrated or not, depends of your product, to get there. The second lever, yeah, build in your product a way that other people will go and talk about it, share it, invite it, whatever, going viral. And the third one is create en masse marketing assets to get you out there, that people can find it, that your SEO gets better. For instance, yeah, it's maybe a good example. All of you have a website, right? You all have a website, correct? I guess, yeah? No, not yet? That's a crime. Okay, but tomorrow you have your website, right? Now when you know how to do it, you can have that tomorrow. In there. Yeah, be careful, that's a good point. Like creating a website in there, what you can do 99 designs to get a nice design. But it means you only have a picture, how it looks like. You have how it looks like. You still have to go and make it a website. So typically, you go to 99 Designs, get the design ready. You go to, you can go to Fiverr here, because you know what you want. Look, somebody who knows, for instance, WordPress, if it comes WordPress, or whatever, or Drupal, if you're, which is a bit more heavy. But let's say WordPress is the most used platform. To translate it from the design into the WordPress website, will cost you, I don't know, $20, $30 max in there, then you can use Fiverr. So that's one way. So the design will take a couple of days because you want to give feedback and choose in there. Moment's finished, 24 hours later, it's WordPress, you post it somewhere, done deal. Yeah? You want changes, whatever, that's one way. Or you can say, yeah, but that will cost me $500, but it's $550, I don't have $550 to spend in there. What you can do is go and search for a theme in WordPress. Yeah. Browser costing between €0 and €10, something like that. Take one from the thousands out there, it takes you some time, the ones that you like, how it looks like, and ask somebody on Fiverr to make it custom for you. And it will cost you like $30. But then you take a standard theme, right? You go to 99 Designs, you have made for you like you wanted. That's the shortcut if you don't have a budget. $30 or $50 max against $500. It depends your budget in there. If you want to do something quick and dirty, go the second way. If you want to do something it's important, you want your design right, your logo, what it looks like, especially consumer brand, it's important, then I would go for, not this, but especially not this, but for 99 designs. Again, it depends. Be creative. The point I want to make is, yes.
And then, so for my website, I want to make it like a copywriting and stuff like that. So I have an idea what I want to tell on the website, but then I first make a design on Fever, WordPress, but then the actual text and all those bits of information.
Yeah.
I want to get that right.
Okay. That's a good question. So basically, there are three things. So we have the design. If you want to separate that, not standard template, you have design 99 designs. Translate into a website content management system like WordPress, Drupal, whatever is out there. It's the second part, and it's still the content part. The question is about the content part, right? In there, I would assume in the beginning it's very light what you want to do, right? Just like this is the product, contact details, whatever in there. My recommendation is to write yourself in there. If you want to do it in language which is not your primary language, native language, you can ask somebody on Fiverr to proofread it for you and maybe adapt it in there. But to me, for the first version, honestly, I would do it just myself. It's not like heavy text. And to get the wording right, because it's your product, it helps you to make your own USP clear. What is it in there? But you can ask people to review it from the language point of view of give input. But own it yourself. It's like you pitching me for your product. It's something you should know and master yourself in there. It's too early to go to a professional copywriter and put things. It's just too early. First version is get it right good enough. Get somebody to make sure it's not like stupid mistakes. I mean, it's not good, not professional to have mistakes on a website or in a text in general, that you make sure in language you don't master. Or master, you want to make sure, if it's Dutch or French, ask somebody that you know that can do it for you for free. That's easy. But if it's like another language, English, ask somebody to $5 to proofread it, maximum $10. That's good enough. First version. 1 year from now, if you have success, we can talk again, have to go to the next level. But don't over-engineer it, right? It's important, but not the key thing to invest a lot right today. Okay? Other questions about this? By the way, you can also create an app for $5 if you like, but it's not something I would go live at, right? We can do it like a dummy prototype to play with, but don't go and buy for $10 and say, hey, I have an app and I can put it on the market. It will be a bit searchy, but it's possible. You can also have people making that kind of stuff or claiming to do it for you. I forgot what I want to say next. Oh, yes, that was my question. You have a website. Who is live longer than a year from now? Who is like, went live last year, 2016, with this website? You do? Do you mind?
Sure. You don't like the website, we're completely changing
it. You don't like the website?
We don't like the website.
No. Okay, let's show us. How does it look like, the website you don't like? Okay. Thank you. I don't think it's a bad website, is it?
Well, there is a number of things because the dent is white and shouldn't be white. So it's still looking.
Oh, the picture. Ah, okay.
Picture of the dent.
Ah, okay, okay.
I like. There's some things I like.
Yeah.
So some.
I don't think it's a bad website at all, actually. But okay, I can see that.
I made this myself.
You can hire him on Fiverr for $10.
I like the style, but there's a lot of little things that I see that I don't like.
Yeah, because you're looking into the so deep. But I mean, from first view, I don't think it's bad at all.
Okay.
In here, by the way, if it's a visual product, I agree with you, you should spend a bit more money or time on getting the pictures really right, because that really counts if you're a physical product. The one of you who have something physical, that's really important, how things look like. This website, for instance, if you look into that, you will see that it has some ranking. I took here Alexa. Alexa is like a ranking of websites globally. So the number one is the most visited website in the world. Who would that be, you think? Google or? Or Facebook, yeah. It's always one of these two, right? In there. Number two, the second most, the third. So in this case, your website, Flinktent, is the 10,778,884. Don't laugh. Being in the top 50 million is an achievement. There are 1.3 billion websites in the world, And he is in that, you know, top 10 million.
Top 1%.
Sorry? what did you say?
I'm top 1%.
Yeah, I think that's an achievement. And the ones who love, I'm happy to invite you and show your website and see where you are. Top 50 million is an achievement in there. More important is it going up or down, but it's a different discussion we're not going to do today in there. So this website is doing pretty well, but I'm sure there are others doing better. We have a bigger marketing budget. You have also better page rank, organically, whatever. So you need to find ways to pass them. You don't have a lot of budget. An example would be, that's why I showed you all this marketing stuff, is it's typical a good example to make a video about. Right? It's something you can easily make a video about. So you do a video about this tent and the environment, whatever you want to do in there, explaining. Or you can do the voice yourself, right? I mean, if your voice or your partner's voice is good enough, feel free. That saves you another $20. Now, the key thing is, you can upload this video that you make on the cheap on YouTube, okay? Who owns YouTube?
Google.
Exactly. Google will pick it up. Now, here's the key to success. You need to copy the transcript, the text of what somebody is reading in the video in the comment fields. Why? That way you have SEO impact. People can find it back easily. Why is it important? If somebody looks for, I don't know, recycling tents or something in there, and it's worded using your text, it means you get picked up by Google themselves, and you will end up in the top five. Number one will be your competitor, number two maybe you, and three is maybe something, a website information. But it can be number five, but you're the first visual one. Because it's video, you will see the small video. So you see text, 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 and you see, boof, you are the video. This is why marketing assets are so key. Not just because it's cheap to make against the big boys. It's a way to put your things forward. Yeah. If you have pictures, again, the ones with physical products in there, like these pictures, or the better, the new ones in there, put them on Pinterest. Okay, not because people on Pinterest will go and look for this site, it might be, which is great in there. Bottom line is you will score on pictures much higher. If somebody says in Google pictures and looks like tent recycling or whatever in there, whatever it is, you will end up very high. Okay, again, thanks to Pinterest. So creating marketing assets is a way to increase your footprint. This is the key thing. Okay, if I check his website, for instance, see if he did a good job. Let's take here. That's a Belgian. It's a Belgian company from Brussels, doing very well, reviewing websites. So let's go and check Flinktent and see his score. Just to be clear, he needs to get 75% at least to pass the test for me. If he doesn't get 75%, he has to improve. That's gamification, to make it exciting and if we make it or not. The bets are open. I'm afraid we're getting at 48%, which is fine. It means you can improve it quickly in the next couple of hours. 75 is not very difficult. What I did now, I went behind the scenes to check what happens on his website. For instance, everything which is orange can be improved. Everything which is red is has to be fixed. Green is great. An example. Here, no meta description on the website. What this means is, if... Let me show with another example. Maybe it's better. Let's take a bigger company, KBC maybe? KBC. Let's first see if they're making 75%, and then we see the difference with, if any, what I mean by filling it in, the meta description. 68 already, wow. Almost there. 72.2. Let them run, but bottom line, here you can see the difference. So they filled in the meta description. Op onze website kun je aanmelden in KBC Touch, blah, 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 blah. Length 150, that's good, because it has to be maximum 165, I think. Which means if you go to Google, you search it, you will see this showing up. Okay? So how can you help? The title tag shows on Google, so you know exactly that's the tagline, if you like. That's the website, and this is exactly what it says. If you go to the looking for your website, what you have is you have just this tagline, which is a small one. It says the same thing as the name of the website, and I don't have more information, and you leave it empty. That's a missed opportunity. You have the chance here in 160 characters. Don't go more than that, because then it cuts off, which is very unprofessional. How much time do you need to fix that?
2 minutes.
Okay, $5, right? It's just like creativity, like what I want to show in there. You fill in the title tag, like KBC did. You put here description. Done deal. Your points go up, but also visually it's much more easy. People say, ah, that's what I need. I click on it or not. So here, everything which is red or orange, we can fix. Let's see. That's not important. That's good. What I like what he did here is all the pictures he has, except for one, apparently, they have a name. So this is like the picture, every name, have description, image, that's okay. But he puts there in the attribute of the picture what it really means, which means if you put it there, this is like a tent in a festival. If you're looking for these words, it will show up also as results. So that you did well, except one. So it means that you have 17, you forgot only one, you have to fix. This kind of stuff helps you to pass your competitors. This is the whole point of doing that. And this is why the last story, creating marketing assets, but put them in a smart way, like video, like pictures, like whatever, is the experiments you want to go and growth hacking. These things you don't often have to remember. If you are interested in doing that, if this is the way forward, how do you put in pictures there? What you have to take attention to, why you put on Pinterest or video. You can become a member of two Facebook groups. Number one is called Copy and Conversion. Mm-hmm. This is the kind of tricks you will see there. And the other one is Badass Marketing or something. It's very good content in there. These are two Facebook groups which are always talking about how to improve this kind of stuff. Not this, but where they're going to publish this typical number of tricks and tips, and because it's always changing, today it's this, next year it's that. I mean, a book cannot keep up to that. Just become a member of that, take a look once in a week, not every day, and you get new input like, hey, I can do this, I can do that. So, but you need, of course, to create also your assets, you know, the videos and the pictures and the text and the copywriting. You know how to do that right now. I'll give you some examples. Go and spread the word. This is about spreading the word. All right? And then, lastly, but very important, now that you understand the principles of growth hacking, one thing is very important. You are a startup. You're very likely building your products right now. You had your idea ready. You have your solution in place. You're developing your solution in there. The key thing is to get product market fit. Is something new, product market fit, or did you hear it before? What is product market fit? Yes, although I would argue that's also here, right? I mean, if you have a product that you created for a certain customer, you can also argue it's also here. But indeed, it's not the wrong answer. But I'd like to have more specific.
The moment when you manage to match the value you create with the and be able to capture that value back from the
Yeah, that's not a bad answer. What he says basically is make sure that this, because here you have your product matching your customer, the example you're giving, but you can also argue that here you need to have your business model in place, what you mean by value capturing. Somehow you need to have a business model, right? I mean, sometimes just charging them, sometimes it can be something else. Just make sure you validate your pricing, your business model as well in there. But bottom line here, you want to have market traction where people like your product or using it, you have certain retention, you have a way to grow your customers, acquiring them. I will not give all the details, but these are the important thing here. What I want to tell you is that if you don't have this stage here, don't put a lot of effort on your scaling and your marketing and your growth, right? You might still be here. Because if you do it here too early, spending a lot of money and effort in finding customers, your product is not ready yet, you're losing a lot of energy for nothing. Basically, think about the buckets, what which is a lot of holes. If there's too many holes, don't add more water to it. First fix the buckets, the holes in the bucket, and then add water, okay? So growth hacking doesn't start here, although you can do some validation and testing. It goes as of this point here. This is the whole thing. This you want to go fast. The best way to kill your product is having a poor product with great marketing. It kills you. Great marketing, fine, but a bad product can really kill your brand and what you're doing. So make sure that your product is good enough before you can scale it up and get growth hacking techniques to get a lot of customers. Okay? That's the key message here. I'm sure you know all these companies. This is Zynga. They was indeed the gaming company. All of them became big because they used one of these three levers. Mobile Vikings is a Belgian one, which is virality kind oriented, but the majority of them went into growth hacking approaches to grow quite big with relatively small amount of money. You can become a member of the Growth Hacking Belgium meetup. It has now 2,300 members by now, by the way. It's much bigger in there. Every couple of months we do an event. It's for free. And we invite people to tell their experience. So like three startups giving their own pitch, how they did it, what works, what didn't work. You can be a member. And if you have time, you're always welcome to join one of the upcoming events. The rest are details, I think. And don't contact me unless you have a specific question in there. I have like 3 to 5 requests a day, so don't expect an answer. If it's something important and urgent, and I guess it is if you contact me in there, you can always call me. That's why I don't have the number there. But happy to give you my number. When I'm in the car or I'm driving, I'm always calling back. I get missed calls, but I always call back in there. Sometimes it's easy to call me and get an answer than try to figure out things yourself in there, as long as you don't spam me. I.e. don't contact me more than twice a year, both it's spam. But happy to give you answers. All of you are looking for answers because you're a startup. You have a lot of questions often. If you believe it's in my area of expertise, it might be pricing or growth hacking or whatever else I'm doing here, community building, I guess, and lean marketing, you can give me a call. Just come to me after a session, I give you my number, and you store it somewhere where you can use it in the future. Any other questions? No questions. Okay, so this is a very good session or a very bad session, I don't know. I hope that I managed to give you some guidance in the world of growth hacking. I hope you get now a perspective on growth hacking, some new insights, things you didn't know yet. But above all, I hope I inspired you to apply what you were learning today, because it's a real proof of the pudding. And it was a really pleasure to be here with you today. Thank you so much.